Thank you very much, Mohit. I would do a very short presentation on active damping and then show why this can be useful for chatter mitigation. So this is the general outline. I'll just introduce feedback control systems, then open loop and closed loop transfer functions, root locus plot, and stability issues which we can understand from root locus plots. Then I'll talk about collocated and uncollocated systems, and then give some examples of active damping with direct velocity feedback. So very simple example of a control system is the shower that we take every day. I think it's working. You can use the mouse, it's not a problem.
Where does it get switched off?
Ah, okay, okay. Take it. Oh. Sorry. So suppose I would like to have the right combination of hot water and cold water. Basically, my hand will act like a sensor. I'll touch the water, and the hand, the sensation that I'm getting through my hand will give me a feedback as to how much cold water I would like to flow into the system so that I can maintain a temperature. So this is an example of a very simple feedback loop system, and of course the human brain is sorry.
This one, the delay is significant actually.
Yeah. Delay is also there.
you get
a burnt hand. So this is once again the involving the brain, the nerves, and the muscles, and the body temperature. And also you might have a more mechanized system of control of the level of water in a tank. So basically, a feedback control system can be shown in this diagram. So this system is basically the plant or the machine or the instrument that forms core, the part of the core part of the system. And it is giving you some output which you are measuring with a sensor. And based on the measured output, you make some comparison with the reference. And if there's an error, you feed it back through a controller into the system, so you control the system output. So this is an example, very simple representation of a feedback control system. Now, I'll be talking about basic concepts of control systems applied to structural dynamics to develop some understanding of active damping through examples. So I would talk about the SDOF oscillator, single degree of freedom oscillator, which has a mass, stiffness, and a dashpot. So this is the basic equation. I'm going into frequency domain, and there we get a relationship between the displacement variable, which is capital X, and the input force F, and omega is a particular frequency that we are considering. Basically, I took a Fourier transform of both sides. Now, if I do the same thing in Laplace domain, there are certain differences, but idea is the same. I want to have something called a transfer function, which is the ratio of the displacement to the input force. And this is the expression. Now, I come to the concept of pole and zero. Now, suppose if I have an undamped oscillator, that means that C factor is zero. So the relationship is 1 by ms square plus k. Now the value of s at which this denominator becomes 0, you would understand that xs becomes tends to infinity. It reaches a very, very high value. So that particular value of the frequency at which this response becomes very, very high, that is called the resonance frequency. So now you see, at s is equal to 0, at 0 frequency, the entire function becomes 0. So this is basically called the 0 of the system, or the 0 of the transfer function at frequency 0. And it is also known as anti-resonance. Okay. Now here, in this particular case, the frequency comes out to be 0. But there might be other cases where non-zero frequencies, at non-zero frequencies, this transfer function can also become 0. It is possible. Okay. So this is the concept of a pole and a zero. So transfer function, we always try to make this numerator divided by denominator thing and try to see what are the roots of the numerator and the denominator. okay, to find out the poles and the zeros. Now, this open loop transfer function, which means you have the force input, this is your plant or the system, which is denoted by G of S, and you get the output. So, you have the open loop transfer function, which I have already introduced. Now, if you have a closed loop transfer function, basically you are taking the output, okay, you are feeding it into a controller, basically multiplying this output by some other function H of S, and then you are multiplying with some gain. This is some static value, static constant, it can be 1 or any other value. And then with a negative sign, you are feeding it back, and this is superposing with the input F of S. And this is generating the total force that is once again going into the system. Now, if I now want to make our relationship between XS and F of S, then you see the denominator is changing. Okay. Now, the values of S for which the denominator becomes 0 are the closed loop poles. So, it is similar. Here actually I showed something else, the denominator becoming 0. Now, here if you solve this characteristic equation, the roots of this equation will give you the poles of the closed loop system. In an open loop system, if it is undamped, you will see those roots, the roots of the denominator, if it is undamped, they will rely on the imaginary axis, complex conjugate roots. So, that is the standard form. And if you have damping, they move into the left side of the imaginary axis. Depending on the extent of damping, you will have the conjugate roots. So, this is very basic. Okay. And if you have this damping coefficient which is less than 1, the free oscillation is actually a decaying sinusoid. Okay. This is also pretty much standard. And if you have the roots of the open loop system on the left side of the imaginary plane, the system is unconditionally stable. It is not going to be unstable anyway. Okay. But so the poles of the closed loop transfer function, now there is something else for the closed loop system. If I change the value of G from 0 to infinity, then we can see that the closed loop poles actually migrate towards the left part and ultimately coalesce with the 0 of a system. Okay. So, for G is equal to 0, the poles of the closed loop system are the same as the poles of the open loop system. Okay. Now, if you put G tending to infinity, you see this denominator is becoming taking a very, very high value. So, the ratio is tending to 0. So, when you take G is equal to infinity, the response of the system actually approaches the 0 of the open loop system. Okay. So, for 0 small g, for gain is equal to 0, the small g is equal to 0, the poles of the system are the poles of the open loop system. For g tending to infinity, the poles of the closed loop system are the zeros of the open loop system. Okay, this is also standard that we understand from the root locus plot. Now, this is an example of a stable system where all the poles are confined to the left side of the imaginary axis. But closed loop systems are not unconditionally stable. So, there might be cases where the pole is actually migrating towards the right side of the imaginary plane. And this is actually the limit of stability. Okay. So, these are all linear analysis theory. So, I would just quickly go through multiple degree of freedom system, because most of our systems are having multiple degrees of freedom. So, you might not be familiar with this kind of representation of a MDOF system. This is similar to having several masses connected to each other in series through a series of springs and dashpots. Actually, my civil engineering background is actually making me draw this, because here the mass is actually here. These are the masses, these are the stories of a building, and these are the columns which give actually the stiffness. So it's the same thing. You just imagine it in the form of series of masses connected to springs and dashpots. That's all. So once again, if I want to solve this, I would do a separation of variables. I would go into modal coordinates, and I don't think I need to repeat this. So ultimately, you will have an equation in modal domain like this. Okay, and if I go into from time domain to Laplace domain, only the z double dot becomes s squared, the z dot becomes s, and everything else just follows. Okay, the only thing that we need to notice is that this mu I, this diagonal mu I is the modal mass matrix. This is the modal damping matrix. Modal damping matrix. I am assuming that we are taking Rayleigh damping. The damping coefficient C is a linear combination of the mass and the stiffness matrices. That's an assumption that we are making. And of course, you would have the modal mass multiplied by the modal frequency square. Okay. And the right side, just because I did a transformation, actually, I pre-multiplied it by phi transpose. So this phi transpose is coming here. And B is basically the influence vector. It just gives you the degree of freedom where you are applying the force. So here I am applying the force at the last degree of freedom. So it consists of several zeros and then one. Okay, it activates the degree of freedom where I am applying the force. So that is the B. And F is the F of T, I mean that function, the forcing function. So everything is in Laplace domain.
Mass proportional damping.
Yeah.
Only mass.
Yeah, mass or stiffness. Yeah, mass. Or sometimes you can also have. Right. Yeah. This is mass proportional.
Yeah.
Yes. You're right. So I would like to have a transfer function between the displacement here and the force applied here. So what I'll do? So this is the nth degree of freedom. So this comes here divided by f of s, and this is the expression, I mean from the previous equation only I am taking. So this is the expression that I am getting, the transfer function between the force applied at the nth degree of freedom and the displacement at the nth degree of freedom. Now if I want to have a general relationship between the jth DOF where I am applying, where I am measuring the displacement, and the kth DOF where I am applying the force, then of course it depends on this B matrix. When they are the same degrees of freedom, this B transpose and B, they are the same. When they are not the same, you have the BJ here and BK here. Everything else remains the same. Okay? So now if J is equal to K, it's a collocated system. That means your sensor and the input and the output are measured at the same degree of freedom, non-collocated when they are not. And if we plot the transfer function as a function of frequency and amplitude and phase, for a collocated system, you will see you will have alternate poles and zeros. Okay? Whereas for a non-collocated system, you may not have that kind of property. And this is actually a very important property that controls the stability of the process of active damping. So here, this is a basic scheme for active damping. Here is the same mass with the spring and the dashpot. And you have some actuator which is actually feeding the force. Okay? So what you are doing is you are measuring the acceleration with an accelerometer, which is the sensor, and you are feeding it through an integrator. That means you are measuring acceleration, you are then integrating it, multiplied with some gain. The gain can be 1 also, or any value which you are choosing, and you are generating a signal, a voltage, and you are feeding it into the actuator. Okay, and the actuator is applying the force once again to the SDOF system. So the equation becomes like this now. So you have minus gx dot on the right side. Okay, now if you take it on this side, then you see you have increased the damping of the system. And if you increase the damping, of course, the vibrations actually die out faster. So that's the basic concept of active damping, and this is the feedback loop diagram for this one. Now, if I do some root locus analysis, if I want to solve for the poles of the open loop of the closed loop system as a function of g of the gain g, then I will see that the root locus plot will actually go like this and then come back and coalesce with the 0 here. Okay, you can check the closed loop transfer function actually. So the 0 it will have a 0 here, and for g is equal to 0 you will have the pole here, and it will come from here and ultimately coalesce here. So everything is on the left side of the imaginary axis for any value of g. You can go theoretically, you can go up to infinite value of gain and get very high damping. Okay, normally we tend to remain in this side. So I mean this is pretty much okay. The more you increase the gain, the more damping you are getting. But there is an assumption here, the actuator dynamics has not been taken care of here. We are assuming what we are feeding in is exactly what the actuator is delivering to the SDOF system. So I applied the same thing on that MDOF system and I made a root locus plot. So once again, since this was a collocated system where I am measuring and delivering the force at the same DOF, I got a nice alternating zero pole configuration. These poles correspond to the modal frequencies of the structure, okay, and interspersed with the zeros. And then I changed the gain. I saw that the first mode, this gain, due to this gain, the locus, the poles are actually migrating towards this side and then coalescing here at infinite value. For the second mode, simultaneously it is going like this. The loop, the size of the loop is actually becoming smaller and smaller as you go towards the higher modes. The effectiveness of this control is best for the first mode. There is something related to controllability and observability. I mean, I am not going into that details. If you, all I can say is that if you want to control a particular mode, you put the sensor where the mode is most observable. Then you can control that particular mode very well. Okay. Maybe at this particular position, it is not observing the fourth mode that well. Okay. It is observing the first mode of the structure very, very well. But this is actually the first mode of the structure, the deflected shape. So that's why it's controlling it best. And you will have somewhat some other differential levels of control achievable at the other modes. So this is once again the closed loop and the open loop transfer function. So you see at the resonance location of the resonance frequency of the first mode, you are getting very high damping, reduction in the response. Second mode somewhat, third, fourth, they are not that affected. Now this is an example where I tried to test a non-collocated system. So I measured the acceleration here and fed it back with the actuator here. So it's non-collocated. So here you see when I first plotted the open loop poles and the zeros, so 0, pole, pole, 0, pole, pole. So the alternating pole 0 configuration, it's gone because of the dynamics of the measurement, I mean of the system. So now you see, now if you change the gain g, okay, this is getting substantially damped, but this one, second mode, is becoming unstable after a certain value of g. So you cannot, this system is not unconditionally stable. There is a certain value of g beyond which this will just blow up. Okay. So that's the problem of having to do active damping with a non-collocated system. Perfect collocation is also not possible. It's very ideal, but you have to try the best possible possibility to keep them as close to each other as possible. That's the practical.
So suppose we are putting multi-sensors then?
So it will be overlap of several, superposition of several effects. So you have to see, you have to check which one is becoming unstable. These are all CISO, single input, single outputs. I mean, you can have multiple inputs also, but I'm showing with CISO systems, okay? Single input. You can have MIMO also, but then you have to check everyone, each one of them, every combination.
Even multiple sensors, actuator is only one.
Actuator is only one.
One sensor, it is collocated, but yes, for the remaining sensors, it is uncollocated.
Yes, so yes. So automatically, it will affect all.
Continue.
So now, I wanted to show something if you have a real actuator where the actuator dynamics is there. So I used an active mass damper. Active mass damper is basically nothing. You have the primary SDOF system. On that you put small mass, a certain percentage of the main mass of the primary structure, with a spring and a dashboard and an active element. That this might be some, I don't know, magnetostrictive or piezoelectric or whatever, something that converts electrical signal into force. Okay. So, so if I do now the dynamics of this, now see there are like 2 degrees of freedom now. So the equations become coupled. You can do this. It's very easy. Okay. And if I do the entire thing, closed loop thing, so what I am doing here, I am putting the accelerometer here and I am integrating and getting a velocity feedback and I am feeding it here. Okay. This active element is actually putting a force on the mass, the damper mass, as well as a force on the primary mass. Okay, because of Newton's law. So this we can derive the closed loop system. So the structural dynamics is this. This is the main structural dynamics. It is giving you the acceleration and you are integrating the acceleration through a gain, and the signal that you are getting, that's acting like a force on this smaller mass. Okay, and the smaller mass is transforming this to another force which is being applied here. Okay, this comes from here only, from this matrix, two dimensional thing only. So now if I, yes,
FT should be feeding to the primary mass also, to the,
yes, yes, mass. Yes, yes, here it's coming. No,
no, but in the block diagram,
this one
FT should be acting on this structure also.
So this is G multiplied by, I think this representation is, I have to check this one, but
yeah, something is not,
yeah, yeah, maybe this block diagram, this, yeah, there's something needs
block
to be changed, yeah,
is not correct.
Yeah, yeah, this one might be something else, I have to check that. So if I now do the
before that block,
yeah, yeah,
so there should be a branch point coming from there after G. It should go to FT.
I think so, yes, yes, maybe something here and then also here, right, right. So this one, so this is a SDOF system with the actuator. So there are, like, you see this, there's a zero here, there's a pole, sorry, zero here, there's a pole here, and once again there's a pole. So it's not a collocated, strictly collocated system, despite the fact that you have the accelerometer and the active mass damper located at the same location. So here you are able to structurally damp the system, but you see the actuator mode will become unstable after a certain value of gain. So you cannot go beyond that. You have to check where the actuator is becoming unstable and adjust the gain accordingly, because you don't want to destroy your actuator also, the active mass damper. If it starts to become unstable, then it will destroy the spring and everything. It's going to burn or something like that. So you cannot do that. So this is not strictly, I mean, once again, it's if the actuator dynamics is there, it's not a an unconditionally stable system.
So this MT, KT, CT, these are representing the actuator.
Yes, actuator properties. Yes, yes. So if I apply the same thing on the MDOF system, we found the same thing. Okay, the first mode was damped highly, but again that is controlled by the stability limit of the actuator mode. Okay, the others are also getting, so the gain corresponding to this value, this will decide the maximum damping that you can achieve on the multiple degree of freedom system. Okay,
but if you change your the measurement from the acceleration to the displacement, then the zeros will go away.
No, there's an issue here. So active mass damper, you need, so the entire theory is based on, you have a like a seismic excitation, you need acceleration input, then only it works. If you need to put in displacement feedback, you need a different kind of actuator.
No,
suppose
you have potential,
yeah,
is,
yeah,
right now the instability is coming because the zero is at zero.
Yes,
at the origin.
Yes,
but if you, instead of acceleration sensor, instead of the accelerometer, if you put a displacement sensor,
you don't have this.
Then differentiate that to get the velocity signal, and then Then the zeros
but,
will go away.
But the S will come, no? If you are differentiating, you are multiplying by S. This is velocity feedback only.
No, but in your close loop, the transfer function, the S square in the numerator will go away.
This one, you mean?
This S square will go away because your output will be the displacement.
Yes, so, so it will be.
So once that zero is not there.
But you, on the other hand, you are differentiating here. Here you are integrating, there you will differentiate. So it will, it's going to come back somewhere. It's going to come back.
Closed loop transfer function.
And it does not work with this system actually. The displacement feedback does not work with an active MOS damper. You need the acceleration input. Otherwise, it does not work. Some other kind of actuator may work actually.
The problem could be because of noise and when you do, because you have to do differentiation.
Yes, yes. Differentiation is always a problematic thing. Absolutely.
And then the integrator itself also has trouble, no? Because integration, there is this integration drift that will be there.
The constant, you mean? Actually, we tried to do that. The instrument that we are using was a charge amplifier. Somehow it was cutting off that DC part.
It cuts, but it will not always cut. So there is always an.
See, the instrumentation limitations are there. That's true.
That is what.
Yeah.
We're going to get one. You will see. We're going to get this.
You have done something.
So, this is. This is the gain, like what I was trying to say, that it is not, it's controlled by the stability of the actuator. At this particular value of gain, the red curve is actually the damped response. So you are getting some damping, but then if you are increasing it, once again, it's like the actuator has become unstable and it is contributing to the instability of the system rather than actually dissipating the energy. So there's a problem, there's a limitation. So direct velocity feedback is one of the most popular methods in active damping literature, and it is it ensures unconditional stability if the sensor and the actuator are co-located. again, as I showed, their actuator dynamics system is not unconditionally stable. This is most likely the scenario that we are going to encounter in a real problem. So please keep the actuator and the sensor as close to each other as possible, and then you have to tweak and check, manipulate what gain you are going to use. And active damping actually works around the resonance peak regions. The other regions, it won't work. So if you want to damp out the resonances, then this is the best method. And the interesting thing, it does not require an accurate model of the structure. Nowhere I am using the dynamical model of the structure in the implementation. So it's a model independent method. So I will go to the part where this can be used for damping of chatter. But I also have some observations. Maybe Professor Wahi may have a look. This was from my PhD work, and I'll go directly into, these are all introduction, you already know all of these. So I was working in the linear domain. My forces are actually proportional to the chip thickness. Okay. So we used this closed loop model, which is the famous model of merit for the chatter modeling. So GS is the machine tool transfer function. That's why I wanted to show those slides before, just to have an idea of a closed loop system. So machine tool transfer function, and you are having the machine tool vibration. So one branch of this is going this way. The other branch is due to the time delay. The time delay of due to this tool rotation appears in Laplace domain as e to the power of minus s of t.
We've seen
this,
huh? We've done this.
Oh, you have done that. Okay. 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 No problem. No problem. So I'll just quickly skip to that. Now what I wanted to show is this one, the root locus thing. So if you solve the characteristic equation of the closed loop system once again and want to have a look at the evolution of the poles, here the k cut is your gain parameter, okay? And I used a very basic kind of approximation, which is called Paddy approximation, to simulate this delay, this time delay. It basically converts this into a rational fraction, kind of thing in terms of S, so that you can plot the poles and the zeros. You have a numerator and the denominator. So low k cut, I mean zero k cut means you will have only the structural pole, and due to this this delay, you have infinite number of poles which are called the delay poles. What we observe, if we increase the k cut, the structure pole of course becomes unstable first. So that's where the chatter starts to happen at certain values of t. Okay, so it goes to a zero. The zeros are located here, 1 by t, 2 by t, 3 by t. Okay, so they start from here and then coalesce here. The delay poles also migrate, but they have to migrate a longer distance before they become unstable actually. So this is the interesting thing that we observed. So all your instability is governed by the instability of the structural pole mostly. Okay, now we found out something. I mean, this is also well known. Professor Wahi has already covered this. Can be, this is Merritt's formula actually. You directly have a relationship between the asymptotic threshold of the stability that's proportional to this xi, actually xi and xi square. Okay, and when we plotted the stability lobe diagram, we found that this last lobe, a majority part of the last lobe, is actually where the structural mode is becoming unstable. Okay, similarly here and so on. There are parts of the stability lobe diagram at very high values of stability where the delay pole is actually becoming unstable. So this was something that we observed as a result of our study. Then of course this you have already done, and these are the regenerate. This is the periodic milling force which has time varying periodic coefficients. Okay, so I'm not going into this one. So we observed that this is a two-dimensional problem where the tool was actually oscillating in this direction as well as in this direction, both x and y. And we recorded the displacement. I believe that this was simulation only. So at certain when in milling we took the displacement output, we did the FFT and plotted the amplitude as a function of the frequency. So the thing we observed that we had the tooth passing frequency. I would believe that these circles here, we have multiples of tooth passing frequency. And along with that, we have a chatter condition, chatter frequency. So in this particular case, I think it was chattering more in the y direction than in the x direction. So there are two chatter poles corresponding to the structural frequencies in those two directions. But I believe, if I remember correctly, it was undergoing chatter. It was chattering first here in this direction, in the y direction, and subsequently it started to chatter here. So the amplitude is less here. So this was a kind of half bifurcation where the basic chatter frequency is close to the structural frequency. That's what we observed. Now another thing, and that can be generalized with this, where omega, actually it should be omega n, which is the natural frequency of the system, plus minus 2n pi by capital T. Okay. The other one was a flip bifurcation where chatter frequencies are located at odd multiples of 1/2 of the tooth passing frequency. That we observed also. So this is once again the FFT amplitude of the displacements in the x and the y directions, and we have these frequencies. So these are the tooth passing frequencies, and you are having at half, then 1.5 times and so on. So this was a case of flip bifurcation which was happening, and that could be generalized by this formula. I mean, we observed this in our simulations. So here is a typical stability lobe diagram for upmilling and downmilling. I believe this was all simulation also. So we, and from time domain simulations. So we observed hub bifurcation in low stability regions and flip bifurcations in certain parts of the high stability regions. So for upmilling, it was like very difficult, like to generate this stability lobe diagram. It's not as nice as the turning. For milling, it's more complicated. For down milling, it was still okay. I mean, I found a smoother representation of the stability lobe diagram. So these were all hub bifurcation regions, and here suddenly we saw the flip. Okay. So there's hub bifurcation both x and y also here. One side is undergoing chatter, the other one is not that chattering that much because the coupling might not be that high between the two directions. So I come to the augmentation of damping and through active damping and how it can increase, help us to mitigate chatter. Of course, this is already the same thing. And here, this is a representation. This is the structure. It can be the machine tool structure. All you have to do is to have a sensor, which can be an accelerometer, and integrate the acceleration signal and put it back into an active mass damper or any actuator that you can use. It can be any other sensor also, as Professor Wahi is saying, that it can be a displacement sensor also, but we have to change the controller and the actuator in some other form. So if you have collocated systems, collocated sensor and actuator, then these are the different basically, what if you sense displacement, then you need to put a controller of this of the form of a lead. Then if you have velocity, then you can feed direct velocity feedback. If you are using acceleration and feeding it into an active mass damper, once again it's integral, integrate the acceleration and feeding it back, or you can use this kind of filter to feed it back. Then if you are using a piezo, then you can have a positive position feedback kind of this kind of controller you need. And if you are sensing force, then you can use this integral force feedback. If you have a collocated sensor and actuator configuration, any of these schemes are going to give you good results. They're not going to be that much unstable. Okay. So this I think is the same thing that I showed in my previous slides, just how the damping is changing, modal damping is changing when you are feeding back the velocity. So what we found for turning is that also this has been already covered in the previous presentation. We are seeing this upliftment of the stability region, and this is directly related to the feedback actually. This is one expression that we found out, the limiting value of the K. How is it related to the chatter frequency and the spindle speed and the gain and the original damping coefficient of the system. Now we did this numerical simulation for milling. So this one, the blue curve is without any active damping and the red curve is with active damping, and we got some good results over here. All of them, like many regions, like this region is typically raised. But this is numerical simulation, time domain.
Can you go back?
Yeah. Yeah.
So why is it that you see only increase, so much more increase in low speed region like you said, but you also see that in high speed region?
It has something to do with the type of chatter phenomenon that is happening.
This is a multi-degree of freedom system?
Yes.
Yes.
It's also got to do with which,
yes,
mode is being,
which mode is being damped, that is also there.
Yeah.
Because
this is very important. Because
yeah.
We did modal testing of the structure.
Yeah.
If you remember, there are multi degree of freedom system, many modes. This damper cannot damp everything.
So there were two dampers actually. The two dampers acting.
Spend time multi-degree.
Yeah.
A little
two
about
dampers,
yeah.
And only 2 degrees of freedom that he's considering.
Yeah.
So this
yeah.
is all numerical simulation, not real.
Yeah, yeah. This is numerical simulation.
I think the point is just to motivate for everybody is that dampers can damp specific modes. They can only damp what they see.
Yes, yes, yes.
For example, if you have a column, yeah, and you mount the actuator on the column, if the column is vibrating, it will see vibration, it will damp it. But if the tool is vibrating and the actuator is on the column, it cannot see it.
Yeah.
So it cannot damp it. Otherwise, yeah. You will not get this uniform damping across all spindle speeds.
Yeah, but that's a local tool vibration.
Yeah.
But the non-collocated thing is there, but the idea was that you're from the turning experience from turning, see, it's related to the structural damping of the system. Somewhere it's there. So if you are able to enhance that, then it will also automatically take care of the global response of the system, which is going to increase your the stability. But of course, if you can sense the tool, then that's the best thing.
But the thing is, we cannot see. Because you can never mount an actuator as a tool.
Yeah.
In turning or in milling.
I'll show you something. I'll come to that actually.
Sir, you are applying this active damper on structure.
Okay, I'll come to the photo. Yeah, I have.
Another thing from that.
Here. And they had done it, actually, near the tool.
Not really at the tip of the tool, but.
Nah, somewhere close by.
So, how can we find out the location of means? Where to put the.
So, you have to do modal analysis first. And then you know where the mode is having maximum displacement, which degree of freedom has the maximum displacement. So you place it there.
And you need mode shape.
Mode shape.
And where the displacement is maximum, mode response is maximum.
Modal displacement is maximum, yeah. Mostly the first mode. Yes. Mostly cantilever, it's dominated by the first mode. So that's why people, it's easy for us to make a decision. But if it's a very complicated structure, yeah, you have to actually check for this thing.
But you can't really put it where the maximum displacement is happening for the cutting tool. The cantilever, the maximum first mode, maximum tool.
Yeah.
Is at the
at tip.
You can't do it there.
Yeah.
You have to put it somewhere back.
For the kind of tools we use, end mill, but if you have a face mill, it's very stiff.
Face mill, yeah, the, this one.
The structure is more flexible.
No. It's a superposition. The displacement is a superposition of all modes, right? So whichever you are sensing, it will control that. If you put at a particular DOF, where it's sensing multiple modes, where the displacement contribution is from multiple modes, it will damp all of them simultaneously. So it will damp out whatever it observes. It can be one mode, it can be multiple modes.
You go to that figure again, you see.
Which one?
That figure where you showed that. It is like, not there where you had the first, from the numerical simulation what you showed.
Stability.
That
next slide.
Yeah, you can see that it is able to control where the hub bifurcations are happening, but the flip bifurcation.
Yes,
it
can't yes,
do.
Yes, it cannot do.
Because that is something that is not related in that. To get the flip one, you have to do some other calculations. And
but flip are already higher. They are already high, more stable.
In that regime, it is not. In this spindle speed. It is actually the flip bifurcation which is governing.
Yeah, I mean, in other words, for example, compared to this one, in the original undamped system, this was already high. So you won't improve flip.
Not there.
Yeah.
No. Like a speed of 850 RPM.
Yeah.
It's the flip one, and that is
lower. Flip you cannot do with this.
There are ways
So, I wanted to show you a demonstrator, like why a demonstrator in the very first place? Because before you do a lot of cutting tests, you could actually develop a smart mechanical system which simulates the chatter and give you some preliminary results, experimental results. So, what we did, we assumed that the machine tool is being replaced by a cantilever structure like this cantilever beam, fixed end is here. Okay, and then we placed some actuators, some voice coil actuators, it's the electrodynamic actuators, very simple ones, in the two directions, in this direction as well as in this direction. Okay, and on the other sides we put some displacement sensors, we used eddy current sensors in the first trial, then we used laser vibrometer to measure the displacements. That means if you are exciting this way, this sensor will sense the displacement here, and if you are exciting this way, this sensor will sense this way. Once you have the displacement information, you feed them as inputs. They are like your regenerative or the current tool displacements. You are feeding them into a milling process simulation that that contains the delay, that contains the spindle speed basically, that controls the delay, that contains the thickness of the cut and all the machining parameters that you need to feed into the machine. So you put in there, these two go into there and the milling process simulation. So this is the user defined inputs for the cutting parameters, spindle speed, depth of cut, and then down milling or up milling. So this milling process will calculate the milling forces. So this entire simulation takes place inside a computer, basically on a digital acquisition board, DSP board. And then you take the output of the milling process as voltage signals and feed them into a current amplifier, which actually energizes or sends the signals to the voice coil actuators. So you create an entire closed loop chatter simulation system. This is a hardware in the loop system. The hardware part is the beam, which is simulating the structural dynamics, as well as the sensors and the actuators. And the software part is the milling process, where you are feeding in the cutting parameters and the spindle speed, etc. And you can change the cutting parameters inside the computer and change the milling condition and see where at what value of K cut it is becoming unstable. So this is without doing any cutting test, we could do that. So first of all, we tried to do with a simple cantilever beam, one dimensional for this thing, for turning. So laser vibrometer measures the position, the displacement signal, and then you feed it into a simulink block which simulates the turning process. And then from there you take the output as a voltage signal, excite the voice coil actuator, which actually once again excites the beam. Let me just check. So here is the beam actually, and it is fixed at this location. And there is a housing. Inside this housing, you have the voice coil actuator, which contains a magnet and a coil. Okay. The magnet is actually inside this housing, and the coil is a hollow aluminium coil, I mean a hollow aluminium block, so cylinder, on which we wind the wires actually. And so it's this kind of system actually, this kind of system. So one is moving like this. This is the static part, the magnet, and this is the voice coil actuator, and here is the beam. Okay. So you excite the voice coil actuator through the there are wires through here that excite the voice coil actuator, and the beam starts to vibrate. On the other side of that beam, there is a reflector for the laser. So the laser is coming here and getting reflected back into the laser head. This is the laser head. This is the actually laser splitter. There is some like complicated laser based measurement systems there. This is the laser reflector actually. It is aligned. And that's what measures the displacement.
In this case, we're measuring displacement.
Yeah. But this is for the chatter simulation.
No feedback
for the chatter.
Not for
control. To destabilize. Okay.
I think the person is asking why didn't you not use an accelerometer?
Accelerometer here, I'll tell why. Okay, I'll just go to the Just
no, the next to that zoom is that is the right thing. Okay.
Make it full. That is
yeah, full.
Full.
So this beam was very small. If you put an accelerometer over there, it will change the structural dynamics, the mass of the accelerometer.
We have accelerometers with 3 grams of
mass. No, no. Your case, the machine is huge.
No, no. Even we have 3 or 4 grams of accelerometer.
Okay, we didn't have that. The professor wanted it. That was the main thing.
The smaller the mass of the smaller accelerometer, they cannot really go to very low frequency. Low frequency, they will not get. Well,
I think low frequency is 20 hertz
and
below. This is not
20 hertz. Yeah, this was higher. Definitely higher. So this.
I think we saw you with a small one, you could measure up to 30, 40 hertz and below.
Yeah.
There's noise.
Reliability is only comes in this way. Or
reliable
is the low frequency.
Yeah, yeah.
So low frequency, the bigger ones are.
Yes, of course.
So this was the stability loop diagram that we generated for that demonstrator, and we got a nice match between the experimental and the theoretical or the numerical actually, numerical results. And this was just to have the repeatability, test of repeatability of the system.
So sorry, how to detect unstable regime in experiments?
Yeah, so basically that beam will start to vibrate very, very large. I mean, you will experience, yeah.
You say cut off, is it vibrates more than this is chatter?
Yeah, so basically, initially, intentionally, you will choose a high value of K cut. So basically, you will do a bisection kind of thing, a high value of where it is becoming unstable, and then a low value where it is okay. So you are, anyway, you are seeing the, you are recording, yeah.
I think what he is asking is, in the stable regime, was your beam stationary or was it vibrating?
No, it was vibrating, yeah. So you are recording the vibration.
This is for turning.
This is for turning.
No, turning you will not get that two of them, no? The stability diagram.
No, it's not, here you will have another one, the last one.
No, but that kink that you are getting over there.
That's for the second mode. So.
Turning with two modes.
Two modes, yeah. This is the superposition of two stability load diagrams. There are some nuances that I didn't cover here.
So that is the second cantilever mode that is.
Yes, second cantilever mode which is giving the stable.
No, but I didn't understand. How do you detect unstable?
Unstable, so basically you track the response of the system. Okay. So when it was like about to diverge, you looked it on the screen. I mean, it was manual only.
And because it is all linear right now, no? The cutting for model that has been put in.
Yeah, it's linear.
And
yeah.
Here there is no out of cut something also, so it will keep increasing.
Yes, it will keep increasing.
And,
yeah.
It is at that point where the actuator, nonlinearities, everything will come in picture. Somehow it will saturate also, but.
It does. We never went to that because the actuator will get destroyed if we.
Desaturated actually.
Okay.
Destroyed the coil also.
Okay. So this was for the 2D system. I think it's a little bit crowded slide. So this was once again the beam with 2 degrees of freedom at the end. And we were measuring the two directions. And we are also exciting in the two directions using voice coil actuators. And this is the detail actually. A lot of stuff is in there. So along with that, we tried to damp out the vibrations using an active mass damper. This was an additional thing that we added onto the system. I think the diagram will show you in a better way. Let me just go back to the diagram. So this was the scheme. So this was the beam, and here you had the chatter simulation layer containing the voice coil actuator and the displacement sensor, and feeding back through the milling simulation in the computer. In parallel to that, we had two active mass dampers that would be used to damp out the structural vibrations. And of course, you had an accelerometer on the other side, and we would feed it back into the system. Same thing the other way. Okay, two independent loops, independent of this chatter loop.
So, your structural dynamics now include dynamics of the actuator.
Yes. So, this was the effect of active damping for a slotting example, we could simulate different kinds of milling operations. So this was slotting, and we found that without and with active damping, we could increase the level of stability. So for upmilling also, we could increase the stability limit.
But somewhere it was actually without damping was stable, is now unstable.
Here, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
That regime over there.
Yes. Yes. So yes. Maybe it's a different kind of the chattest instability, hop or flip, whichever. That was actually governing that. You could have that effect also. Yeah.
This is surprising.
So this.
This happens. This can happen.
Do something to control it.
Yeah.
Some regime where it was not chattering.
Yes.
Might start chattering.
For example, in structural modification, when you do change of geometry or material, it's called a waterbed effect. You suppress one, but the other one climbs.
Other one climbs. Because
yeah, yeah. The problem is I forgot to put the MPEG actually. This was from Soralutsa, the IDECO group. Yeah, so basically this was an MPEG. I mean, I have to tell you now. Initially it was under control, and afterwards they switched off the control, the active damping, and then it started to chatter, and you could see the chatter marks, and there was a marked difference in the sound, the quality of the sound. But I don't have, unfortunately, I have not kept the MPEG along with this face milling thing. I think Dr. Law also is familiar with this group.
I'll show them the video.
Okay. And this was the one that was implemented on Huller Hill. I think the company is now owned by that elevator making company, Schneider. I think they're now with Schneider Electric. So they also had these actuators installed on their milling machine. And they said that, okay, when the control was on, they got a reduction in the response. But I doubt they reported, I mean, when I was there, I don't think they reported any milling tests, actual milling tests. Okay, so only the Spanish guys actually, they continued on the research. And this is like almost 10 years back. So the Spanish guys have continued on the research, and they have continued to build on where I had left, actually. Yeah.
There are two actuators like in series. What are the other ones?
This one?
Not yours, the Huller Hill.
I think the sensor.
No, both sides they put.
No, actually, yeah. Yeah.
Both sides.
They wanted to have more control, so they increased the mass.
But that was very strange, because this is like spring in series, no? Actuators in series.
So, but that depends on what kind of actuator.
This is a moving mass.
Moving mass actuator. It has to have some symmetry probably. They didn't want to make the systems unsymmetric.
One of them is pushing, other one is pulling, so that you effectively get the combined.
Maybe that's the reason.
So 45 Newton can be made 90 Newton.
No, but the way these actuators work is they only apply a pushing force. There's no pulling force.
No. That comes from the inertia.
That is why they have put two of them. No?
Yeah.
One to apply force in this direction, one to apply force in this direction.
Yes. Or maybe they are moving in phase also. You never know.
Actually, if it can only apply a pushing force, then two is required. Then two is required.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you will not be able to send it from the other side. That is why two is there.
So they may apply different forces. No, this is the same actually.
No, same thing, I think. I think they didn't want to make it unsymmetric. That was what I remember as of now. But
force application is proportional to gain.
Yeah.
So depending on how they tune it, it can apply
Yeah.
Different loads, but at a time only one of them is probably acting, because you would want to, because if they are both of them pushing, then they are cancelling each other's effect.
Yeah.
If it's a bending mode like this.
For any mode, if both of them are simultaneously, if they can only push, does not make sense to keep both of them on always. Only one of them should be acting at the time.
But this is the bending symmetrical mode.
Eh? Whatever be the case, if both of them simultaneously are on, they are cancelling each other's effect. No? Doesn't make sense.
So they have to push or pull.
Yeah.
And pull.
Yeah.
This will damp only in particular
direction. Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, no, no. See, this one I remember, they had a predominant mode in this direction. So they only wanted to do this one only, you know, only this one. The other one was like far away, they were not bothering too much. They were not worried about that one.
So the difference is if you have a total structure with some improved amplitude.
You need all directions.
Yeah.
Yeah. Multiple.
Direction.
Sorry? Yes, they are targeting the weaker direction.
But
yeah.
This does not look like the weaker direction. Is the tool point?
I have no idea.
No.
I have no idea. This was a just.
This is a schematic. This is a picture.
This is a picture. I mean, this is a CAD, AutoCAD diagram. I think so. I mean, it's a schematic still.
It's not a real.
I don't think it's a real one. The other one was real. I mean.
Show you the other real application. This one.
They wouldn't release the picture, so I couldn't put it.
Yeah,
oh, you have it. Okay.
It's on YouTube actually.
Okay, I think that's all that I have for today. If there's questions, I can take.
So you have done the active damping here, all the velocity feedback. But the same thing can be achieved if you take the displacement and you do a time delay corresponding to that.
Yeah. So time delay, we didn't want to introduce those poles, the delay poles, those kind of
several
things.
Several of them will appear.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Because when you take. Suppose you have displacement sensor only.
Thus, Nijat Olgat's work is based on that only.
Yes,
yeah.
So
time delay.
That
yeah.
Two frequencies can simultaneously be controlled.
Yeah, but then if you time delay, if I remember correctly, you can.
You choose the delay appropriately because
that was the problem.
That
was the problem. I mean, our lab wanted to have something very very robust under various situations. So. Through several trials, we ultimately reached this conclusion that direct velocity feedback is actually working in all situations.
So direct velocity feedback, but then the problem with the sensor.
So
accelerometer is required, and then you are integrating it. But suppose the integration is something that you are not able to get rid of the data, then what to do? The displacement sensor, you numerically differentiate. There will be numerical.
So there are pros and cons with everything.
No,
yeah.
But there at least the drift is not there.
Okay.
So the
drift is not there. Yeah.
So in fact, if you tell me.
But I'm very sure that the instruments that we used, they were like almost 10 years back. So they were taking care of the DC part very well.
Sometimes you cannot.
So really?
Sometimes it
becomes. Okay. Okay. Okay.
We have done some experiments here.
Okay.
We did accelerometer, we wanted velocity signal.
I used a Bruel and Kier charge amplifier.
That would use that.
What okay.
Bruel Kier charge and normally takes
it. Yeah, it takes care of. I mean I remember you have to have a band pass filter actually.
Yes.
So you will cut off the very low frequency components and then
there is a low frequency, high frequency.
Yes, exactly. So we.
No, that is for the in the acceleration signal that is what it will.
No. You can the output also you can. Output you can after the integration you can also put out the output. So basically okay even if it does not do you can also bandpass your output signal so to take care of the low frequency component.
We were doing some.
Okay.
The acceleration it was not working.
Okay.
So finally to get the.
Or you put the high pass filter. Some kind of high pass filter you use, so it will not allow the low frequency.
Was always there when we were trying to get the velocity.
Okay.
So it can happen when the cables are damaged.
Yeah, the ambient radiation can also.
Cable extending into the accelerometer. If there's a small
something, you normally get those things. Finally, what we had to do is.
What kind of frequencies were you seeing?
Frequencies were low frequencies.
I mean, some like 20 hertz, 10 hertz.
Yeah.
Because normally the ambient is 50 hertz thing is always there. So, okay.
But low frequency, it is very difficult to measure acceleration.
Yeah.
So the big accelerometer was what was used.
But
better to use displacement sensors.
That's why I shifted to the laser vibrometer, but it's very expensive.
So we had to go to
laser.
Okay.
Laser vibrometer we use, then differentiation, that is what we use.
Okay.
But then if that is the one, if suppose you have the displacement sensor only, if the application is such that you only have displacement sensor, then, but if you want to do velocity feedback, you have to recognize that S by S plus A, and that S plus A introduces another dynamics to the sensor.
Right.
You use a delay, then it is more advantageous.
We didn't explore Olgach's work actually, because we wanted to have a very robust system that works at various spindle speeds.
Yeah.
And this is more or less that we struck upon gold and then just okay, just go with it.
Yes,
so
what you're talking about, this group from Spain has played a lot with changing delay, seeing the effect of that filtering. They use notch filters.
Yes.
To remove, because the actuator is not as dynamic. There is low frequency noise, there is high frequency
noise.
They filter everything.
Yeah.
And they've done a very interesting good job.
I have not followed them.
They produce a lot of good work.
In fact, last 7 years I have not followed this literature. That is the problem.
There is a lot of interesting work. In fact, this is also very interesting. To build hardware and loop simulator.
Yeah.
To be able to simulate chatter on setups to understand it better.
Without really cutting, because when you are cutting, there are a lot of other things that come into
play,
which you are avoiding.
Yeah, we are avoiding them.
And this is why if you can do this on a real milling head, on your because we know how to simulate that.
Right.
We know if we have a real test structure, you can test all these without really cutting and telling you exactly what is going to happen. Because you will damage things otherwise during cutting.
But here, that is one problem, because over here, because you are not really cutting. There are many facts related to when you are real cutting.
Absolutely. That's true.
Those effects also have to be brought in. This to be.
No, but if you're really interested in just looking at active damping. The simple linearized stability model.
I'm not talking about that. What I'm saying is that when you're doing the real cutting, then there are all kinds of things that are there. There is friction between the tool and work.
No doubt. That's
and all of those things are not in these models. Hardware in loop simulator will simulate only if suppose everything was idle, only cutting forces were present.
No. You can introduce those if you have models for that. Do you have models for everything? As long as you have models for those phenomena, you can also incorporate them in the hardware and the loop also. But probably real cutting you can never reach. That's the thing.
Or to record real cutting data. Record that during instant.
Yeah.
Put that as an input into the system. Instead of simulating it, record the real cutting
data. Yes. And feed it for excitation. Yeah. But how will you? You have to record the chip thickness. I understand what he's suggesting. If you can somehow measure the chip thickness history.
No. What he's suggesting is that you.
No, then it's an open loop. It will never get unstable.
No. There is nothing. Instead of that simulation block, you just record what is the displacement of displacement in x and y direction recorded.
Okay.
And you just feed it to your simulator. Instead of the simulator, the real data will be used to give that much motion to the tool, and then you apply it to that.
No. It's not that. You need the how will you simulate the regeneration?
No regeneration. No feedback loop required.
No, it's required. Chatter requires regeneration.
No,
that's based on.
Instead of
what he's saying is just the open loop thing you can do. That's okay.
That's what he's saying. So the open loop, you have the recording of x and y displacement.
Correct.
During a chatter phenomena.
Correct.
And that is what will be used so that you are.
But the damping
the structure
doesn't come into it at all. The damping signal doesn't get into the actual.
After that you apply.
No, damping is totally independent. So that's what totally independent of this one. See, these loops are totally out. They are out of the chatter simulation.
This chatter simulation.
Yes.
And this feedback
to replace this by the chatter displacements x, y.
Okay.
Record it.
Okay.
And use that to force the system to have that motion.
Yeah. And it can keep growing, and then you just damp it.
So that is what. Okay. We can talk
yeah,
about
we'll
that.
Talk
no?
about this becomes very interesting.
Can we do it in a motor? So by yeah. bearing the torque in the motor, so can we do it as a damping system?
You want to vary torque in motor?
Which motor?
Which yeah. spindle motor?
Not the spindle motor.
Axis motor. Yes, there is something called structural damping. But that's not the varying torque in motor. It's control.
But actually, there is another way to control chatter, which is by modulating the spindle.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That is also there, yeah.
Yeah.
But there's a limitation by the inertia of the spindle. There are a lot of practical limitations to spindle speed variation.
But then they can be
see, there's a trade-off. You can make a very big, like very highly sophisticated electronics that fails miserably. So.
The title is machine tool maker, so useful value. Group now has what they call chatter pro.
Okay.
Plug and play device.
Okay.
Monitor signal, microphone, acceleration, torque, or motor power.
Okay.
Motor current. Yeah? And real time monitoring, depending on which speed region you are, because lobes, in the lobe speed
yeah.
region, you don't have any pocket.
Right, right, so
you
right.
Spindle
right.
speed
variation, yeah.
And in the high speed, you do spindle speed selection, you go into the pocket.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So during cutting, the moment you detect chatter, you stop.
Right.
Pause
here, right. Right.
You change the spindle speed either to go in the pocket or you sinusoidally
vary it.
And then you start.
Sinusoidal variation change. That way, if I do a tool change, everything gets scattered or automatically.
Yes, this is online real time estimation.
No,
we are not going to do this with some of you people. We'll demonstrate it.
So, with that spindle speed modulation, what happens is that the time delay is no longer constant, it becomes a periodic
yeah, yeah,
time
yeah.
delay. And because of that periodicity, it can stabilize the system. But it can, whatever was not chattering, so whatever was chattering has now become non-chattering, but some regions which were not chattering could become chattering.
But then again you detect it, you stop it.
Okay. That is where, but no, just if you do spindle speed modulation.
But sometimes you cannot, right? Sometimes you just cannot avoid chattering.
Yeah. So it has to be, the parameters have to be chosen carefully.
That variation of the spindle speed will be very less. Even if it gets 1 or 2 hertz.
Yeah, low
signal. Which is enough. Because it doesn't allow this phase to build up like that.
Yeah.
Anyway, this is interesting. This is also very interesting.
Okay, I think. Is there any question?
Good. So
okay, thank you.
Let's thank Dr. Ganguli. Yeah? And we have a small gift for you.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you.